Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, I am Edwin Garcia. Welcome back. This is lecture three of the second week into the introduction of the material science of rechargeable batteries in nanoHUB-U. Today I'm going to talk about different applications for material systems for describing the thermodynamic potential of the different battery materials. And what we were discussing last time is how, as we specify the free energy of mixing for different compositions in a battery material, that being cathode or anode, the common tangent construction will allow us to specify a region where the chemical potentials becomes flat, translating directly as to a plateau, a region of constant voltage that could be very useful to specifying the voltage of the cell. And if instead we have regions where only one phase coexists, then the voltage will be dropping or maybe increasing, right? Basically will be varying, will not be constant as a result of just putting more material into that phase. Okay, and of course, at some point, that voltage will drop to a value that that is not usable. So we related this, we were able to relate this to a phase diagram. And what I'm going to talk to you about is a couple of examples, a few examples showing you how this construction allows us to specify the voltage potential and how the voltage potential can directly relate also to a phase diagram description. A very nice current model, experimentally used system is the lithium iron phosphate system. Here on the left, you have the phase diagram. Here you have the temperature axis versus the composition. You can see here the amount of lithium. This is based on results published by Meeton, Huang, Carter, and Chang. It's a relatively recent paper. It happened in 2007. So here what you have in the diagram is different particle sizes of lithium iron phosphate. So to the left, for example, if you focus only on the red dots, any material that has a composition to the left of those red dots will have only iron phosphate, and any material to the right of the red dots on this side of the plot will have only lithium iron phosphate. And in between, you have coexistence of iron phosphate and lithium iron phosphate. Now, the reason that you have different curves is because the red dots corresponds to one size, the green dots corresponds to an even smaller size, and the green dots corresponds to an even smaller size, basically changing with that the region of coexistence of iron phosphate and lithium iron phosphate. Okay. This ended up being technologically important because you can actually tune those particles to be so small that the contribution from surface tension to describing the energetics of the system can completely suppress the two-phase coexistence of the system, changing with that the voltage response. Okay, so if you look at the red two-phase region, that corresponds here in this voltage versus capacity plot, which really corresponds to the amount of lithium that we have put in it, to this very long plateau that the material will deliver, right? This is at a very slow C rate. This corresponds at C over 50 for these samples A, B, and C as they were drawn over there. Now, if instead you use the green dots, what you will find is that plateau shrinks a little bit. Shrinking with that, the length of the width where you get a voltage of 3.5 volts. And similarly, if you make it even smaller, that even further decreases the plateau. Again, this is occurring at 21 degrees C, which is roughly here, and you can see how that also shrinks the plateau here, right, to the region where the voltage becomes flat, also decreases. Now, what you have here is, my understanding is the same type of response, but in this case, we're looking at a window very close here, so you can see these spikes in voltage as the material is trying to find the equilibrium of the system. Now, in this case, corresponds in the other direction. As you go from a discharge state to a charge state, and this one goes from a charge state to a discharge state, and you can see how the shape of the curve, it's altered by the region in which both phases can coexist. And for sample A, which corresponds again to the blue dots, that plateau becomes much shorter as a result of the region of where both phases can coexist. Okay, and this shows you really the importance of understanding how two phases, in this case, the iron phosphate phase and the lithium iron phosphate phase, are interacting to specifying the shape of this curve. And well, as a result of that, you have the different types of potentials, and the performance of the system will also be changed. Now, because both phases can coexist, what ends up happening in this system is that the lithium-rich phase actually happens to have a larger lattice parameter and expands, while the ones that have the lithium deficient phase, the iron phosphate phase, what happens to it, it has a smaller lattice parameter. So when you have two of these coexisting, when they're touching each other, they will induce a local stress. So one of them will be in tension, another one in compression as you lithiate it, leading to that, to the possibility of internally cracking the particles that you have. And that's why it becomes so important to tune this regime so that you can control that and basically minimize the amount of stress that the system has and making your battery last longer. What you have here for the same system, and you can see here the curves that you may have, okay, for depending on how the material is stressed, whether or not you have a coherent interface or an incoherent one, okay, and these are results that were published by Cogswell and Bossant in 2012, and this is very interesting too, because see, here you have a delithiated state, and as you put lithium in this system, there are two things that could happen. You could have that the particles can interact with each other, basically inducing nucleation of growth on individual ones, or you can have some sort of mosaic type of description where some of them will be lithiated, others will be delithiated. What you really want is all the particles to basically, as they react, be uniformly fully lithiated. Okay, and if you pick it, if the size that you pick is not ideal, what you will have is an internal distribution of regions, of lithiated regions and delithiated regions, which could lead to failure and could lead to poor performance. Ultimately, what you want is you want the whole system to lithiate fully all of them homogeneously, because if you have one of them at a concentration X beta, which would correspond to somewhere here, that means that you will not have, oh no, X beta is on this side, I'm sorry. If you have something at X beta, which is what you really want, if you have something at X alpha, then you will be losing this much capacity locally in your system, which could add up to a poor performance. Okay. And well, in my personal opinion, this description is a huge victory in understanding how materials behave locally and how we can incorporate the fundamental description of thermodynamics to describe how the material behaves. And by basically taking concepts as simple as something you would learn in a very fundamental class in thermodynamics. And you can apply this to other systems as well. For example, you can think of the bismuth lithium system. Here you have the temperature axis, and here you have the concentration of lithium. So you can see how on one side you will be completely lithiated, and the other side you have completely lithiated. And if you pick, say, a temperature of 380 degrees C, that would be pretty hot, right, somewhere here. Okay, you can see it there. Okay, how in this side we have this, say in this diagram, you have the Li3Bi, which would correspond to this one over here. Okay, you have the LiBi, which corresponds to that one over there. It really shows you how you have at least two plateaus occurring in the system. Okay, and then of course when you have the Li3B system, Li3B phase, then the voltage drops from the 800 millivolts to basically zero. Okay, and this of course is with respect to an aluminum and a lithium aluminum reference. This one over here is with respect to lithium, and this one over here is with respect to aluminum and a lithium aluminum reference. Okay, and so how can you relate it directly? And what you can see here that this phase over here corresponds to that phase over there. So before reaching that, you can see how the voltage is dropping. Basically, we're crossing this distance until we reach this point, okay? Then, since we have that one phase, okay, this is a two-phase region, we have one phase and the voltage undergoes a dip. And now we have a phase of coexistence where the LiBi and the Li3Bi coexist in this two-phase region, okay, giving us that that flat voltage, okay, which corresponds to that one roughly, okay, which corresponds to that point over there. And once it hits it, then the voltage drops until it reaches that final value, okay. If you think about it, this gives you a very unique opportunity, because then you, if you are thinking of batteries that work at different temperatures, all you need to do, given this plot, is try to think of at what temperature, okay, I would pick so that I would have different types of plateaus. So clearly, if I pick a very high temperature, say above 1145, I will not have a single plateau, because I have completely removed any position, any phase to coexist with another phase. But below that, you can see that, say at 800 degrees, I can have a region where I would have a liquid, so the voltage will be dropping until I reach this two-phase system, which will provide me with a plateau. Then I would hit this phase, and then the voltage will drop again. Okay, so if instead I go to a much lower temperature, say to 100 degrees C, which is still a relatively hot battery, I could have this two-phase region, which basically I would start flat, then undergo a second plateau, and maybe an additional plateau here, depending if this voltage is large with respect to the lithium reference. Okay, but you can see how you can use that to your advantage to specifying batteries. And of course, the question remains, what is the temperature dependence of this plateau as the temperature increases or decreases? Here's another example. This is the antimony lithium system. And what you see here is again, multiple phases that can coexist. And, you can see that a temperature of 360 degrees C, which corresponds to a temperature before between these two numbers, okay, there is a plateau, okay, until you reach the Li2SB phase, which corresponds to this line. So you can see how I have a two-phase region there. Okay, then I arrive after I hit that composition, then I have another two-phase system where I have Li2SB in equilibrium with Li3SB, which corresponds to this region over here. Okay, and then at that point, the voltage drops, okay, from, in this case, the 0.9 volts or 900 millivolts that you may have. Okay, clearly showing you again the same type of behavior, and how when we are really measuring the voltage of a battery, as this voltage goes through these different stages, okay, these different plateaus, what we're really doing is measuring the phase diagram of the system, if we do it in this case very slowly. A system that is very commercial and is very well known as the lithium cobalt oxide system. This is a figure provided by, published by Anton van der Ven. And you can see here that for the lithium cobalt oxide system, when the system is fully lithiated, it gives me a lower voltage. And as I take away more and more lithium, I end up in a two-phase region. Okay. I end up with a single phase, and that's why I have the linear behavior. I undergo a structural transition here. I still have a one-phase system, okay, and in between here I have some internal reorganization, and that's why the voltage differences. And then finally I arrive to a two-phase region between these two phases, okay, and then I have one more phase, a two-phase system, and then finally when I have completely run out of lithium, my voltage just starts skyrocketing because my chemical potential is getting close to minus infinity, and that's why I get that slope over there. So this is important because you can see that you can select what phases you think would be more mechanically stable, would have the better conductivities, and take advantage of the different plateaus that you have to have a better response. In the case of lithium cobalt oxide, in this case, the cobalt oxide system that has very little or no lithium, what that will do is that can become unstable. So typically what people do is they avoid this section. They just try to go on that regime to basically maximize the thermodynamic stability of the entire system, because if it reacts with oxygen, it can be fatal. Now that's for the cathode side. For the anode side, you have here on the right, okay, the voltage of the battery of a graphite system as a function of composition. So on this side I have lithium, and on that side I have just graphite. And you can see here how I go to I go through a two-phase system, then I transition to another phase, then I have a one-phase system again, transition again, and then it just goes up. Okay, so you can see this 2L to 2 phase corresponds to this plateau. Then I have a 3 to 2L system, which corresponds to this region, and then a 1 prime to 4, which corresponds to this region over here. And you can see how in this temperature versus composition phase, well, in this case, just identifying where the different phases are at a temperature of 20 degrees, you really are hitting different stages. And as you get to be completely depleted of lithium, the voltage again jumps up again. So clearly when the system, what you want, you may want your battery never to reach that regime, not only because you will not form those additional phases, but also because you will keep your voltage in check. Okay, and that of course will have an impact as to what the capacity ratio of the system should be and how you will be away from a capacity ratio of 1, but will allow you to increase or make your voltage flatter and maybe increase your performance of the system. So again, to this point, what we have discussed is the effects of composition on the voltage response. And now what we're going to do on the next lecture, we're going to talk about the effects of temperature given one specific shape and what's the impact on that. Okay. Thank you. See you in the next lecture.